My name is Tassos. I'm with RF Elements. I run North America operations for RF Elements. And today we'll be talking about our antenna technology and our solutions for fast, sustainable wireless. Our key motto here is to grow smart, reject noise, and save spectrum. So the items we'll be talking about is wireless as kind of we see it and how it pertains to you. We have a couple of use cases. We have a couple of users in the field that will be talking about their experience with our antennas and how you can possibly see the benefits that they have seen using our antenna technology. So today's key challenge is really spectrum. We all know that. The noise floor is just climbing day after day after day. And we only have a finite fixed amount of spectrum. And even in that spectrum that we have, you know, we're constantly fighting the battles with tighter and tighter restrictions for, you know, out of band emissions, power levels, frequency spectrum going from DFS to non-DFS. I mean, we just have a lot of challenges even within the spectrum that we currently have. The ability to use and maximize that spectrum is key for growing and dealing with the challenges that we have today. So again, the main problem is RF pollution, right? That's basically what's happening. The antenna systems that we're using today, or the radio systems for outdoor wireless, is making the RF pollution problem grow at an exponential level. And mainly it's because this problem is created by today's poorly designed gear that's being deployed. And the noise situation that we have is, you know, purely a function of signals that are traveling way past our coverage area, further than we need it to be, and in unintentional directions, directions we don't expect it to. And it could be categorized as basically any signal that's not the intended signal for your target, whether you're generating it or not. If it's not intended for your receiver, then it's considered noise regardless. So basically, RF Elements, we deliver fast, sustainable wireless. And we do that by rejecting noise, creating systems that have zero loss or almost no loss, and we give you massive scalability on a level that has never been seen before. So with that, I'd like to not only tell you how good our antenna technology is, but we have some customers that have used it, and I'd like to share those experiences with you. So today we have with us Matt Hopps. He runs RiverValley Internet out of Pennsylvania.
Basically what we have is a bunch of ubiquity sectors. We've got a lot of 120 degrees. We've got some 45 AC sectors now, and they've been working well to cover some fairly decent large metropolitan areas where we've been competing with Comcast. What has happened is we've started to fill those sectors up, literally just to capacity of throughput. So we're getting 40-ish customers on them. The radios are still doing fine, but we're hitting capacities for throughput. So we needed to do something else. We had looked at these, and yeah, as was mentioned, some of my hesitations were, well, we're going down in signal level. Some of our signal levels are already, neg 65. I don't necessarily want to lose more RSL. I want to keep our throughputs high, our modulations high, things like that. Plus, the design was just kind of weird, at least initially looking at it, going from a sector environment to this weird little horn. So we needed to do something, and they're really relatively inexpensive. So I said, let's buy two. Let's give them a shot. If it's a horrible investment, we'll just throw them out somewhere or return them or whatever. Let's give them a shot. So we got two horns, upgraded the radios from Ubiquiti M to Ubiquiti AC radios while we were doing it, put them in, and they were terrible. Now, the reason that happened was because we aligned them wrong. So literally what we got was two 30-degree horns. I put them on a standoff on our tower, told the tower guy to point them in a certain direction. He sort of got off kilter a bit. And so literally the reason I'm telling you that is because if you get these, I don't want you to curse and swear at them and throw them on the floor like we almost did initially. So it takes some fine tuning and potentially having one of your clients out in your potential coverage area connected to it while you're trying to align it and get it up and down. But once we got them peaked in where they were supposed to be, they've been working great. So to speak to the RSL concerns, the dB values of the antennas, we literally, I don't know that we have seen much of a drop in signals.
Most of the time we're seeing actually an increase.
Well, we're seeing an increase, which is kind of counterintuitive. But regardless, we are seeing a rejection in noise. So previously we had to mostly run DFS channels and lower powers and things like that. With the horns on the tower, we're running in the Uni 3 spectrum, even though there is another WISP on that tower also running in the Uni 3 spectrum, which is not something we could do on the sectors. The sectors would hear the old Alvarion Uni 3 radios that were on that tower. The horns do not hear them. So we're running up in the Uni 3 pushing AC speeds. What have you seen? 100 meg. So we're pushing 100 meg down to clients over the horns. We're doing an install the other week where it was almost on the border of where the two horns were. We had like a neg 65 on the one horn, did a site survey, and literally several blocks away is where the other horn started, and it was like a neg 86 or something like that. So the cutoffs are very, very severe, which is what you want when you're trying to do high capacity into areas. So we also did something which was really weird, and I know there was some discussion about it in the Facebook group. We literally have 18 degrees of down tilt on our horns. We're on, actually, and that number is wrong, we're not quite 3,000 feet above. We're like 550 feet above town, and then like a 100-foot tower. But we have 18 degrees of spot of down tilt because we're competing with Comcast. So literally, there's like this small area of town that we were trying to spot, two areas of town to take load off the tower. But because of the symmetrical way that the horn works, you can spot just a few blocks, or you can spot a small area of town, and you don't hear all kinds of noise. So this is a look at the signal levels of some of the clients on one of our horns. And as you can see, they're pretty decent as far as throughput goes, as far as signals go. And then the air view from the top. Again, really, we don't have a whole lot of noise. That little spike there that you see up in the Uni 3 is actually the other horn. And they're both mounted on the same standoff. 2 feet maybe from each other? A foot or 2 foot from each other, and they hear each other at a neg 42. But literally anything that's more than like 10 feet from them on the tower, I mean, they're not hearing. So yeah, absolutely you can do co-location without GPS sync.
We'll move on to our next user case. So I'd like to introduce to you Matt Harrison from Primo Wireless. He's actually from New Zealand. And Matt, again, like many WISPs out there, was basically maxing out the capacity of his towers were too low. He had limited tower space, long CPE distance coverages, and a mixed CPE environment. He found our horns and installed one, and then just went crazy after that. So Matt, if you can take it from here.
We are very limited to our tower spaces. A picture of one of our towers in front of a competition's tower. So they have a 45 meter lattice tower that costs around about $10,000 a month if we want to put anything on it. However, the landowner let us build our own in front of it. So that's what you're seeing there. The issue we had was the same with Matt. We have 120 degree ubiquity sectors at the top. We did what we could with RF armor to try and get the noise down, and we were reaching capacity on those. Some of those were running about 50, 60 clients, and that's just, no good. It wasn't a good user experience for any of them. So with this particular site, I think we deployed 7 horns with the same radios. So we first off went with the XW Rocket M5s, just in order to move all the clients over to the same sort of radio platform. The next step will be swapping out the twist ports for the Ubiquiti AC once they get sync working. And that will hopefully fix that site. But the user experience from this already, effectively all complaints have stopped. We were able to load, I think, around about 20 clients from, all of the clients from the sectors. I think we averaged between 15 and 20 clients on each horn. So that's a massive improvement. And here's some slides, I think, before and after of some of the clients that we were swapping over. And they were very stark differences running from the sectors onto the horns.
Thanks, Matt.